As we get started this morning, I want you to think with me about a common human experience, something we all have in common. We are all deeply disturbed by other people. We are all deeply disturbed by other people. The way they think, what they say, what they do, it bothers us. We all have this, I would never type of attitude. I would never think that way. I would never say that. I would never do that. And even if we don't say, I would never, we tend to think it. And even if we don't think it, catch this, we feel it. There's a certain feel to that. We can all relate to, can't we? It feels like disdain for someone, or revulsion, or outrage. It's when you click on your favorite news website and read about what's happening out there in the world and you're outraged over it. Or you scroll down your Facebook news feed or your Twitter update feed and you see the types of things that people say and what people post, and you have this sense of, to use Luke 18's term, which we read earlier, the sense of contempt for other people. We all experience that, don't we? We all spend time and use up some of our mental energy thinking about what is disturbing about other people. It's common to all of us, inside the church, outside the church, something we can relate to. And Jesus loves us enough to expose that sin this morning. It's another manifestation of Pharisaical hypocrisy. That's why we're calling this series Good News for Blind Hypocrites. We are all blind hypocrites. As I've said throughout, to insist I am not a blind hypocrite is to engage in blind hypocrisy, ironically. And Jesus loves us enough to confront that area of our lives, not to condemn it, for those of us who belong to Him, not to condemn it, but to free us from it, to liberate us from it. So that's what He's going to continue doing this morning. The Pharisees had the I would never mentality, often fueling what they did and what they said. And Jesus confronts them. And we're going to consider what He reveals here in verses 29 through 39. So this is really the rest of the chapter. He wants to walk through it, say some things about it, and then in the end, we're going to wrap it all up, okay? Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you build the tombs of the prophets and adorn the monuments of the righteous. Now stop there right away. He's referring to actual tombs they had constructed there to honor the prophets of old. They respected the prophets of old, celebrated them. But look what He says next. And you say, if we had been living in the days of our fathers, we would not have been partners with them in shedding the blood of the prophets. If you know your Old Testament, you know when God raised up those prophets and spoke to His people, the Israelites, through His prophets, most of the time they were rejected. In fact, typically there was only a remnant of people who were receptive to the message. Basically, through those prophets, God was preaching the gospel to His people. He was preaching the bad news of who they were, the truth about who they were and their rebellion and their idolatry, and the good news about His coming redemption. Often it was pointing forward to the Messiah who would come to rescue them. But here's what happened. The same thing that tends to happen in our lives. They rejected what they were hearing. They didn't want to be confronted. They wanted to believe that the Gentiles were the really bad people. the pagans out there. And so when the prophet said, no, you're the problem. You're prideful. You're rebellious. You have a lack of mercy. You don't take care of the poor, the widows, the orphans. You're hypocritical. When the prophets would say those types of things as the Holy Spirit of God spoke through them, the people would experience outrage and rebellion and would revolt against them and would persecute them and even would kill them. And Jesus is saying here to the Pharisees of his day, hey, you claim that you're respecting those prophets. You're saying, oh no, we would have listened. We would have listened to them. We would have received what they had to say. We would not have been partners with those who shed their blood. We wouldn't have participated in that. We would never be guilty of that. And look what Jesus says in verse 31. So you testify against yourselves that you are sons of those who murdered the prophets. By saying that, you prove that you're just like them. When you say, we would never, you're rebelling against the message of God, which is, yes, you would. You've heard that example we use today. When you point a finger at someone, you always got three pointing back at yourself, right? That's what Jesus is basically saying here. It's the same as Romans chapter 2, when in Romans 1, where God talks about the human heart and the essence of unrighteousness. And he knows that the hearers there in the church in Rome would be thinking, yeah, that's right, that's those bad people out there, that's the pagans out there. And in chapter 2, Paul flips it. And just like Nathan confronting David says, you're the man. You're the one guilty of those things. And when you say that you're not, you basically testify against yourself. You're judging yourself. You don't even realize it, but you are. Whenever you say, I would never, you're proving that you would. You're proving that you're the same, because we humans have an uncanny ability to justify the evil things we do. The Pharisees were all about. It was all cloaked, wasn't it? It was all covered in this religious exterior. They would talk about their love and their adoration for God. They would talk about their respect and their admiration for the prophets of old and the patriarchs. They would say all the right things. But as we've been seeing throughout this chapter, on the inside, they were greedy. They were arrogant. They were really for themselves, not for other people, which was evidence of the fact they didn't really know God. They thought they did, but they didn't. Look what it says next, verse 32. Fill up then the measure of the guilt of your fathers. In other words, you just continue the same pattern. The same pattern, you're just like your ancestors. You have the same DNA. You want to think that you're better than them, but you're not. You're just like them. You serpents, you brood of vipers, how will you escape the sentence of hell? I mean, strong words from Jesus here. He calls them serpents, vipers, obviously imagery related to evil. And not only that, but deceptive evil. Because in those days, vipers were these little snakes that would often hide under piles of sticks. And so someone would be gathering up sticks for a fire or whatever, and they'd get bit by this viper, and it had a deadly, venomous bite. And he says, you appear to be harmless. You look one way on the outside, but you're really, as he said last week, the section we looked at, you're full of death. And you deliver death to other people. You don't even realize it, but you're delivering death to other people through what you're teaching, your false teaching. How will you escape the sentence of hell? You can't escape. You continue on this path of self-justification, covering, hypocrisy. This is the end of that, God turning you over to what you've chosen for yourself. If you insist on justifying yourself, God will turn you over to the end of self-justification, which is hell itself, separation from God. as we looked at last week, no more hiding, nowhere else to hide, being fully and finally exposed and living in the misery of that for all eternity. Jesus says that's what happens. You can't escape in this path. And as I said over and over throughout this section, when he says, woe to you, I mean, he's pleading with them to see it for what it is. He is pulling the mask down and say, this is what's true. Just look at it. And there is great healing in looking at it. You know why? Because that's what prepares you for the one who's about to go to the cross to provide justification for all of us hypocrites, to provide true covering and the safest place to hide. We just finished singing about it. Hide away in the love of Jesus, right? Verse 34, therefore, behold, I am sending you prophets and wise men and scribes. Some of them you will kill and crucify, and some of them you will scourge in your synagogues and persecute from city to city. God is always sending messengers to his people. He says, but you're going to persecute them. And if you look at the book of Acts, that's exactly what you see. And in fact, before that, Jesus himself will suffer under their persecution, won't he? Because these very people will be the ones calling out for his crucifixion. And Christ promised that's exactly what would happen. He says, so that upon you, verse 35, may fall the guilt of all the righteous blood shed on the earth, from the blood of the righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. Now he's saying, from the first martyr of the Old Testament to the last martyr of the Old Testament, from Abel, first person murdered by his brother Cain, and he was murdered because of Cain's disdain for him and his righteousness, his walk of faith with God. Cain despised that and murdered him. From Abel to Zechariah, who is likely the last prophet to be martyred. You know the book of Zechariah? Here's what Jesus is saying. From A to Z, you are guilty of this kind of bloodshed on the earth. He says, truly I say to you, all these things will come upon this generation. This is happening right now. And I want to stop here and say that along with their respect and admiration for the prophets, I want you to understand they were deceived. They believed that they were sincere in that respect for those prophets. In fact, they thought when they persecuted God's people, and even in their opposition to Jesus, they believed they were serving God by opposing Christ and his apostles. Do you know that? In John chapter 16, if you look there, Jesus promises his disciples, look, this is what's going to happen. There's going to come a time when those who turn you over and have you tried in the religious courts are believing they're doing God a service. They're convinced that they're right, that they're defending the truth. But in reality, they're opposing God. They don't understand the heart of God. They don't understand the redemptive love of God. And they're unwilling to look in the mirror and see the truth for what it is. And so again, Jesus is pleading with them. One last section here. Verse 37 on through 39, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her, how often I wanted to gather your children together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were unwilling. This is Jesus saying, look, hear the compassion of God. He's like, I wanted to gather you together. I wanted to protect you. It's the picture of a hen protecting her little chicks underneath her wings there from storms, from hawks, predators who might try to snatch them up. And it's this picture of God's protective love and compassion. And again, he's pleading with them. This is what I want for you, but you're unwilling. So to apply it right here, right now, are there ways in which we still are hiding, covering? We're under disguise. God is pleading with you. Look, just pull the mask down. There's provision for you. There's covering for you. This is the heart of God. Why would you reject that? Why would you run away from that? You do it to your own peril. And it's not for lack of divine provision. God has done everything necessary. So he says, behold, your house is being left to you desolate. For I say to you, from now on, you will not see me until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Now, this is interesting. It kind of sets the tone for what comes in the next chapter. The next chapter is prophetic, dealing with what's going to happen with Israel. And he's saying, hey, look, your house is going to be left to you desolate. And this is pointing forward. And that's why he said earlier, verse 36, these things will happen or come about in this generation. He's saying, look, in those days, a generation is 40 years. In less than 40 years, your house is going to be left desolate. And what he's referring to is the fact that there's going to be this revolt where the Jewish zealots, okay, there's this part almost like terrorists today, this group of Jewish zealots who were constantly fighting against the Roman occupiers. Well, they would gain some momentum. In fact, as they were slaughtered by the Roman soldiers, they gained even more momentum and more people were joining them in fighting against the Romans. And remember, they wanted Jesus. What did they want from Christ? Why did they reject him? They rejected him primarily because they didn't believe he was really the Messiah, because if he was really the Messiah, he would rescue us from the problem around us. And Jesus says, look, I'm here to rescue you from the problem inside of you. And they didn't want any part of that. They wanted the Roman oppressors put off. They wanted to be liberated. They wanted to be elevated and to be the rulers of the world with the Messiah. That's what they were looking forward to. That's the fantasy they had in their mind at this point. And that was not the way Jesus taught, and that's certainly not the way it played out. He would end up dead, executed, martyred. And they misunderstood. Well, Jesus is saying, here's what's going to happen. Your house is going to be left to you desolate. Consequences. So in that uprising, where the Jewish people, led by the zealots, revolted against the Romans, there was a time when finally the emperor said, enough's enough. He sends Titus, you may have heard of Titus, who was a commander at that time. He would later become emperor in Rome. But he led an army of 80,000 troops down to Jerusalem, and they slaughtered the Jews in Jerusalem and destroyed the temple. I mean, demolished it such that there, so one stone wasn't even left upon another. I mean, they just flattened it and killed all the opposition. And from that point forward, you've heard of maybe the dispersion, the Jewish dispersion. They just spread out throughout the Roman Empire, and they became slaves. And they hid, and they lived in fear, and they were oppressed, and they were taxed, and all of that. Well, that's what Jesus is referring to. That's going to happen. And he says, verse 39, I say to you, from now on, you will not see me until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That's when things will really change, and likely this is looking to the future, even from our day, today, looking to the future when God's people see Christ coming in his second coming and realize what they did and have remorse and repent and believe. And they say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They see Jesus as the Savior they had previously rejected as a people, right? And this all reminds us of who God is, what is true. It's easy to lose sight of our human tendency to fall into these traps, to be guilty of hypocrisy. Again, if we say we're not, in those moments, we're acting hypocritical. If we say, I would never, then we are proving that we would, that we're really no different. So as we kind of wrap it up here, I want to say a few things about our approach here as a church and the way that we teach, and we're constantly looking at ourselves and allowing God to peel back the layers of who we are. And as a rule, we try to encourage you to look at yourself and to resist the temptation and the urge, which is so common in the church, to do the very same thing the Pharisees did, which is to say, yeah, those bad people out there, all the evil people out there. So we're constantly looking at ourselves and saying, even in this section in Matthew 23, hey, Jesus' words to the Pharisees apply to me today. And until I'm home with Christ, these words will apply to me. As long as I have what the Bible calls flesh, this is applicable. But I know it begs the question, And I've talked with some of you about this. Well, how do we understand change then? And what does that mean? And this comes up often in my biblical counseling class. I teach in town once a week. Well, how do we understand change? And aren't we different? And so I want to say a few things about that as we bring this to a close, and how this, I believe, is a consistent gospel-centered perspective. There's this idea, and in a sense, I believe this is true, but in another sense, I think it can be misleading. There's this idea, well, I'm not what I will be, but I'm not what I was either. I'm sort of a better version of myself than I used to be. And it's considered in the context of Christian growth. And on one level, I agree with that, that there's change. God has done things in my life, thankfully, and your lives, I see God doing great things, and I experience fruit in our relationships. So in that sense, absolutely, God is doing things, and there is change taking place. But I want us to be really clear on this. Our flesh is our flesh, and it doesn't change. And it's just as ugly today as it was the day God saved me. And it will continue to be just as ugly till the day that I die or Jesus comes back and I'm immediately in his presence. Until then, flesh is the flesh. And it's got all these same tendencies. And if I think to myself, well, I would never do that. If I look at one of you or look at somebody on, for me, it's like when I go down the scroll on Facebook and I just think, gosh, the stuff people say, the stuff people post on there. And that uprising within me of, I would never, look, that's my flesh. That's me being a hypocrite, a blind hypocrite. And you do the same thing. I know you do. Even if you're not on Facebook, which would make you a very smart person probably. But you have other opportunities to do it. You interact with people, and that feeling of contempt, it's the flesh. It is what it is. It's the same. It will continue to be the same till we're home. And the only remedy for it is seeing Jesus. Seeing him. Confidence. Get this. This is so subtle but so important. Confidence in him, not in me. Not in the newer, improved version of me. The difference between me and a pagan is not me. This is so important. It's Christ in me. It's not me, and it's not you. That's the only thing that can disarm that condescension, that I would never mentality, is seeing a, but by the grace of God, I would be doing the same things. I'm capable of everything everyone out there is doing. As Paul says toward the end of his life, I am the chief of sinners. As I thought about that, a couple passages came to mind. Philippians 3, Paul says, we are the true circumcision, who worship in the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. What sets someone apart from an Old Testament perspective? It was a circumcision sign that God had prescribed for his people. Well, Paul says in the New Covenant, there's a new version of that. Here's what makes us different. He says, I'm going to read it again. Worship in the Spirit of God. Glory in Christ Jesus. And put no confidence in the flesh. No confidence in the flesh. And that doesn't mean, this is another important clarification. There's different types of people in here. Some of you are a little bit more confident. Just generally speaking, the way you go about life, the way you make decisions, you're more confident. And others, you struggle with self-confidence a little bit more. That's not even what we're talking about here, okay? It's not saying you've got to, from now on, if you're one of those more confident, clear-thinking people, it's not saying, well, you can't be that way anymore. You got to be this weak person now and this sort of milquetoast person now and second-guess everything. That's not at all what we're talking about in the natural sphere. We're talking about in the spiritual sphere when it comes to the real important things, like my understanding of God, my relationship with God, my relationship with other people, how I treat people, the attitudes I have. At that level, we're saying no confidence in the flesh. That is an outworking of my relationship with God. That's an outworking of the Spirit of God within me, not something coming from me intrinsically in that sense. Do you follow? That's the Spirit of God in me, through me, when there's good fruits in my life. And we are confident that God who began a good work in us will be faithful to complete it. But it is God who does it. He is the origin of that which is good, that which is loving, that which is life-giving. So another passage comes to mind. And last week, if you were here, I said, one way we can understand our conversion is it's coming out of hiding and into the light. We finally say, okay, God, I'm willing to allow you to show me what's true of me. I'm willing to admit my sin, my pride, my rebellion, my toxic thinking and the habits that are destructive to the people around me. I'm willing to see that for what it is. And in conversion, that's pretty clear for most of us. But then we kind of get caught up in this outward conformity thing, and we lose sight of the fact that the way it really works is that's conversion and that's also growth. It's coming out of hiding into the light. It's being humbled by God and seeing what is true of me still, what is still in that destructive, evil flesh, and letting God show me and liberate me from it. It's this regular coming out of hiding and into the light, agreeing with God about what is true. That's why it says in 1 John, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then he goes on to say, well, if we say we have no sin, we call God a liar. If we say, well, I'm better now than I used to be, you're calling God a liar. Because your sin is your sin. Your flesh is your flesh. And the alternative is a reliance upon Christ and Christ alone. With full confidence in him. We have every reason to trust him. Every reason to believe him. One other passage, John 3. This is the judgment, that light has come into the world and men love the darkness rather than the light, for their deeds were evil. For everyone who does evil hates the light and does not come to the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But he who practices the truth, catch this, comes to the light so that his deeds may be manifested as having been wrought in God. Do you see that? There's such a misconception in the church land that somehow we become better versions of ourselves. And we're getting stronger and smarter. And faith to us sometimes feels like strength. And I believe as we're understanding faith for what it actually is, it feels like weakness. It feels like no confidence in the flesh. It feels like knowing if there's any good coming out of me, it's been wrought in God. That's what walking in the light is like, knowing that to be true. And God gets all the credit. One way we can understand growth is it feels less like confidence in ourselves and more like confidence in Christ. When it comes to the most important realities of our lives, how we treat our spouse, how we treat our kids, coworkers, people living all around us, we begin to see them as the same as us. I tell my counseling class all the time, look, when you sit across from somebody and they're pouring their guts out to you, and they're trusting you with the hardest parts of their lives, if you don't look at them and see yourself, you're going to have a hard time really coming alongside them and helping them. If you have I would never, what's wrong with this? Look, they're going to know that. Whether you say it or they just feel it, they're going to know that there's this sort of superiority complex you have. This is the only remedy for that, is walking in the light of what God says is true, which is, hey, look, if you're anywhere different from them, it's not because of you, it's because of me. That's what God says to us. And if that's the case, then love them just like I loved you. It's liberating. It equips us to have compassion. It's the only place compassion can come from, I would submit to you. I share this last illustration. The class I'm taking right now, Dr. David Pallison is the teacher, and he was talking about interacting with a paranoid schizophrenic. Okay, I don't know that I've ever met someone who would be considered a paranoid schizophrenic. I understand the concept. I've never interacted with anybody who's been diagnosed with that condition, disorder, what psychologists would call it today, mental disorder, mental illness, they would use. But one of the refreshing things he said was when he sat across from this person, he realized in a moment of clarity that he was more like that person than unlike him. And that's what helped him to identify with this patient, to come alongside. That's hard for us to admit, isn't it? That we're literally capable of all the same things. It is. But God says that's what's true. You just look at Romans 1, 2, 3, so many other places. So, Jesus confronts the Pharisees. He confronts us. He was pleading with them tenaciously, but also compassionately. And he's doing the same with us today. And he just says, hey, look, I'm just asking you to agree with me about what is true. To confess, that's what to confess means, is to agree with God what is true. And he's not expecting us to fix ourselves as we begin transitioning into our time of communion. This is why Christ came, isn't it? Mike pointed out in Sunday school's great observation that Christ was always consistent, always thinking according to what was true, always loving his Father, always loving people, always serving people, never blind to his true state, never hypocritical, never one thing on the outside and something else underneath. What you see is what you get with Jesus at every moment. And he lives in our place, and he's about to, in the context of Matthew, go to the cross. He died in our place to become our covering. And God says, so come into the light, admit what is true about those deep, dark parts of yourself, and experience over and over and over again my goodness in covering you, in forgiving you, in cleansing you. And that is what will the grace of God teaches us. As it says, I think it's in Titus, teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. It's the grace of God. It's God's, to put it another way, God's provision for you. Jesus is the embodiment of that provision. And as we trust in him, we're enabled to admit weaknesses, admit flaws, admit those dark parts of ourselves, admit our mixed motives, even in the best things we do, and to celebrate over and over again what he has done, what he has accomplished. And out of that, God produces great fruit. According to Galatians, love, joy, peace, and on and on and on. So, from him, through him, to him are all things. To him belongs the glory forever. Amen? Amen. All right, let's pray. God, thank you for our time in your word this morning, and the clear and penetrating words of Jesus to us. Lord, I pray that we would resist the urge, the Pharisaical urge, to deflect and say, well, that's not really relevant for me, or maybe it's a little bit relevant for me, but not entirely. Other people need to hear that more than me. Resist the urge to say, I would never do that. In their day, I would never reject the message of the prophets. In our day, I would never reject the message of Jesus and the apostles. And yet we have a tendency to reject. When you shine your light and our hearts are exposed and we're forced to see who we really are, it can be difficult to admit. We're blind to it. We can even feel justified, even godly, in rejecting or resisting. But the reality is, God, if we do that, we're resisting you and your Son, Jesus. So I pray that we would humble ourselves, we'd walk in the light, we'd walk in Christ's covering, the only real covering. And along with that, that we would walk in love toward other people. And when we look at others in their sin and their evil and all the ugly things we tend to see in others that we tend to have disdain for, when we see them, God, that we would see ourselves and remember what you did to rescue us. God, only you can reveal these things and teach us these things and cause these truths to be ingrained within us. And so we ask you to do that, that we might walk in fellowship with you and in love for others. So God, do what only you can do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.